going through all that. Thank you, Titus. Okay, good evening, everyone. Could you turn your Bibles? Sorry about that. We had a little problem with the mic. And, actually, it wasn't the mic. It was the board. So, but we got it back going. So, good evening, everyone. Could you turn your Bibles to Haggai? Haggai chapter 1, verse 1. And we're going to be continuing our introduction of this particular book. And the things that we'll be mentioning and have mentioned in the introduction in previous classes and what we'll mention tonight and in the next couple of weeks until we complete the introduction is very important information so that which will help us to interpret this particular book. So we do an introduction to every one of the books that we study. And also, if you look at as I mentioned in the past, a Bible dictionary, and you should have at least one in your library, and there are many different kinds of Bible dictionaries you can get. They're very good. And these Bible dictionaries, if you look up like the book Haggai, it'll go through some of this, a lot of this information that I'm going to be passing along to you. They give it in written form, and I'll be doing this, of course, audibly. And also, the written article, I'll have an introduction for Haggai as well, like I do every book. So, these things that they present to us in the Bible, you know, these various Bible dictionaries about these different books are very important information in interpreting the particular book that you're looking at. So, tonight we're going to be looking at the literary genre and style of Haggai. So that means in order to understand what this means, we have to look at, spend a little time this evening on what literary genre is and also what style is. So in order to understand what the literary genre and style is for Haggai. So we have to get educated a little bit on these two subjects, style and literary genre. So that is our subject here this evening. And as we normally do, we take a moment of silent prayer to examine ourselves, to determine if we need to confess any sins to the Father, if we're harboring any known sin, a mental, verbal, or overactive sin, and we haven't confessed it, we're out of fellowship with God. And the Holy Spirit who indwells us will convict us of that sin, your conscience and the Holy Spirit as well. And so when the Holy Spirit does that, you need to do it immediately, is confess those sins. And when you do that, you're restored to fellowship with God. And, of course, that's based upon the merits of Jesus Christ and his death on the cross. So, therefore, when we are back in fellowship through the confession of sin, we have to stay in fellowship, and we do that by our obedience to the Spirit who speaks to us through the Scriptures which he's inspired. That's when we're filled with the Spirit commanded of us in Ephesians 5:18. So, very, very important. The only way we'll be able to understand the things of God, and Paul discusses this in 1 Corinthians 2, is through the ministry of the Spirit. But if we're out of fellowship, we're actually, the only ministry the Spirit's going to do for us is convict us of the sin. So if we want to grow up spiritually, we want to get the most out of Bible study, whether it's our personal study or sitting in front of our pastor, we must be in fellowship with God. Because the Bible, these people do it, and they can study it and look at it academically and understand a lot of the stuff academically and maybe historically and whatnot. But it's spiritual phenomena. It's information that you're receiving from the Holy Spirit about the Father's will. Not only just that, but what he requires of us and the consequences of doing his will and the consequences of not doing his will, what he's provided for us in the past through the Spirit and the Son, what he's provided for us now, what he's doing for us now, what he will do for us in the future. All these things are contingent upon us being in fellowship with the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So with that in mind, with our heads bowed and eyes closed, let us pray. I just want to shut this off for you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given to us. We thank you, Father, for the spring coming, and the day is getting longer and warmer. And we just thank you, Father, for the sunshine that we had today. And we thank you, Father, for your creation and being able to have the capacity to experience it and enjoy it. And we just thank you also for our relationship and fellowship with you, your Son, and the Holy Spirit. And we just thank you, Father, for giving us grace and giving us the forgiveness of our sins and loving us through the death of your Son, Jesus Christ, and also through the ministry of the Holy Spirit who raised us up and seated us with your Son, Jesus Christ, at the moment of our justification. We thank you, Father, for the person and work of Christ and the work of the Holy Spirit from regeneration to resurrection. And we pray he would do a mighty work to all of us here this evening. And Father, we just thank you for Titus and Jody opening up their home to us and the hospitality that they've bestowed upon us 3 days a week to teach here. I also thank you for Titus's work and all his hard work with the website, the sound, and the recordings, so that allow the people around the world and our internet people to listen to the Word of God. We thank you for his service, the technology, and the people taking advantage of the technology. I pray there be no problems in that area this evening. And I also pray that you would help me tonight to bring forth your full counsel with regards to the subject of the introduction of Haggai and its literary genre and style, so it would help us to understand and correctly interpret this book accurately. We pray that you would help me by the power of the Spirit to be humble and sensitive to the Spirit's guidance and direction, and also help people in the audience as well to be humble and sensitive to the Spirit's guidance and direction. Help them to understand what I'm saying here this evening and help them to apply what they're being taught. And we pray that it would not only help them understanding Haggai and interpreting it themselves, but also with the different books of the Bible in the future, it would help them. So, Father, we just pray for this service. We pray that everyone, as a result of this service, would continue to grow in the grace and knowledge of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So it is in his name we pray. Amen. All right, you should be at Haggai chapter 1, verse 1. And we're going to be, again, noting the literary genre and style of the book of Haggai here this evening, which is quite interesting. We've noted in previous classes about this book, we presented a little bit of an overview, and we noted the canonicity of this book. This book was received by the Jews. It was part of their canon of scripture early on. In fact, immediately when it was published by Haggai, we know that from the contents of the book of Haggai, where the remnant of Judah accepted this book as being inspired by God because they obeyed what Haggai told them, which he received from the Lord. So it's canonicity. Remember, we pointed out the canonicity, a book, whether it doesn't matter what book in the Bible it is, the minute it was completed, it was inspired by God. And then at that point, that is when it achieved its canonical status. It did not become canonical because the Jews said it was a book that should be in the Bible, or the churches said this. No church councils decreed this. All the Christians have done and the Jews did is they simply acknowledged the divine inspiration of these various books that we have in our Bible today. Then we noted the authorship. We noted Haggai is the author, the human author of this particular book. Not much is known about him. The contents of the book don't tell us much, but we do know that he was an individual that was a contemporary of Zechariah. In fact, Zechariah's ministry, that book follows Haggai, he basically was a contemporary of Haggai, and he started prophesying not too long after Haggai started prophesying as well, or communicating to the remnant of Judah. And that leads us to the recipients of this book. It's the remnant of Judah. These are the people who survived the Babylonian deportations, and they came back. They were a little bit less than 50,000 at the time when they first came back. Many Jews stayed in the various provinces of the Persian Empire, which was the superpower that was in control of things at that time. We see that they basically defeated Babylon and absorbed the Babylonian government into its and the people into its system, the Persian Empire. And so that is where it leads us to the historical data, the historical background. Darius Hystaspes was the Persian ruler that was in power at the time, and he's referenced several times in this book of Haggai. So he was the one that allowed them to continue forward with rebuilding this temple. Remember, they had about 16, 17 years before they started to do it. Ezra talks about this in his book. And Ezra was a contemporary of Haggai as well. And basically, that book tells us they started the temple, rebuilding the temple. Remember, Solomon's temple was destroyed by the Babylonian invasions. But the ruins were there, and the foundation was around there. So they found it, and they were going to build on top of it. They call it Zerubbabel's temple, because Zerubbabel was the Judah's governor at the time. So this is all part of the historical background. And this was in the 6th century B.C. And when they finally, when Haggai actually gets this, comes to present these messages that are in this book, it was 520 B.C. In fact, the dating of this these four messages that compose the book are found in the book of Haggai. So there's specific dating for these various messages. The book is based upon four messages that Haggai gave to the remnant of Judah. So these Jews came back, and they were going to they started rebuilding the temple, but they were prohibited from doing so because another Persian ruler came to power, and he listened to the enemies of Judah, who didn't want them to complete the temple and rebuilding it and Jerusalem, so that the work was stopped. Well, comes around to 520 BC, God tells Haggai and then Zechariah, right on the heels of Haggai, to get these people, the remnant of Judah, back to completing the rebuilding of the temple, so they could have a centralized location to worship the God of Israel, who we know is the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, based upon the New Testament revelation. So that's the historical background and the date of the book, which leads us to the literary genre and style of the book of Haggai. Now, before we look at that, let's read the contents of Haggai. We've done this, and each of the nights we've had this introduction, and this gets us familiar with the book, because I know there's many people who probably have not read this book, or listening to us, or watching us online, and because it's not a book that you see taught very often. In fact, you do a little perusal on the internet, various ministries, and if they do have their material still online, you'll find that not many of them are teaching this book. We studied Obadiah. I mean, I bet you couldn't find 1,000 people in the United States of America or around the world who've actually taught this book. If you did, I'd be shocked. So Haggai, Obadiah, very obscure books. So it's good that we read them through, especially when they're small books. Remember, Obadiah is the smallest book of the Old Testament, and Haggai is right on its heels. So read the book, and you should do this anyways. Any book that we've ever studied, I say this from time to time, when we're studying a particular book, read it and read it. Try to read it a couple times a week, or you know, every day if you could. But especially if it's a short book. But you should read these books as we're going through them and get familiar with them and see things that are coming up as we get to it. Because I do this myself as well to get me familiar with the book and get the big picture. You know, because a lot of times when we do, and I try to do this when we're studying, a lot of times we look at the you know, I like to do analogous to a forest. A lot of times when we study the Bible, we're looking not at so much at the forest, the whole book and its contents and the big picture, but we're looking at the verse by verse and stuff, and that's analogous to looking at the trees of a forest. Well, we don't see the big picture if we're just looking at one particular tree all the time. So that's why when we do study these verses individually, or, you know, in these big narrative books like Exodus, we took paragraphs or chapters. I try to look at the verses in the context in which they're found. So every time we study a verse, we're always doing that. It doesn't matter what book we're doing. So if you notice that, I do that. So you won't lose sight of the big picture. Because I've been in ministries where they did do verse by verse, but they were so concentrating on a verse that you lost sight of where you were in the book, with how that verse fits in with the rest of the book. So I've tried to learn from the mistakes of others and my own mistakes as well, try to learn from them and try to get better at teaching these books. So let's look at Haggai chapter 1, verse 1. Haggai chapter 1, verse 1, and I'm going to be reading from the Net Bible. Haggai 1:1. On the first day of the sixth month, King Darius, second year, the Lord spoke this message through the prophet Haggai to Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to the high priest Joshua, son of Jehozadak. These are the political and religious leaders of the remnant of Judah, respectively. Verse 2, the Lord who rules over all says this, these people have said, the time for rebuilding the Lord's temple has not yet come. So the Lord spoke through the prophet Haggai as follows, is it right for you to live in richly paneled houses while my temple is in ruins? Here then is what the Lord who rules over all says, think carefully about what you're doing. You have planted much, but have harvested little. You eat, but are never filled. You drink, but are still thirsty. You put on clothes, but are not warm. Those who earn wages end up with holes in their money bags. Moreover, the Lord who rules over all says, pay close attention to these things also. Go up to the hill country and bring back timber to build the temple. Then I will be pleased and honored, says the Lord. You expected a large harvest, but instead there was little. And when you brought it home, it disappeared right away. Why? Ask the Lord who rules over all. Because my temple remains in ruins, thanks to each of you favoring his own house. This is why the sky has held back its dew and the earth its produce. Moreover, I have a call for a drought that will affect the fields, the hill country, the grain, new wine, fresh olive oil, and everything that grows from the ground. It will also harm people, animals, and everything they produce. So he's disciplining them. God's disciplining them because they're not putting his what he says is a priority at first. They're putting their own interests first, and he's disciplining them. And that's according to the law, as we'll see when we get to these verses. Deuteronomy 28, 29, and 30, those chapters, basically God says, if you obey me, I will bless you. If you don't, I will discipline you. And so we see that he's disciplining them at this time. So, and we've seen these books, we've seen this in Zephaniah and these other Old Testament books. God's using Haggai basically to call the nation back to repentance. And for if they're believers, to confess their sin and then do what he says to do, which is specific here. Rebuild my temple. Complete the rebuilding of my temple and stop putting your interests ahead of my interests. And this is good, as we pointed out, is good to talk about priorities. And this is a big problem that we have, the church in America. The church has problems with priorities. People are putting their own interests ahead of the Lord. That is not correct. And God will discipline believers when they do that. Now, look at verse 12. Then Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and the high priest Joshua, son of Jehozadak, along with a whole remnant of the people, obeyed the Lord their God. So they immediately responded to the rebuke and the Haggai calling them out, they obey him. This is one of them, you'll never see this that often in the Old Testament, where somebody, a nation, the nation of Israel or the remnant of Judah, actually obeys a prophet and what he's saying. Usually they rebel against him, and only a minority, a remnant, is actually going to listen to the prophet. And this has always been true throughout Israel's history. And I also believe it's happened. This is true. Only a remnant in the church throughout its history is listening to the Lord and obeying him. Then it goes on to say, they responded favorably to the message of the prophet Haggai, who spoke just as the Lord their God had instructed him. And the people began to respect the Lord. Notice that obedience to his commands is demonstrating one's respect for the Lord. Verse 13, then Haggai, the Lord's messenger, spoke the Lord's word to the people. I am with you, says the Lord. And basically, that's basically saying, I'm with you in the sense that I'm going to energize you to do this work, and I'm to comfort you and give you encouragement. Don't worry about your enemies around you that don't want you to do this. Because look at what he goes on to say in verse 14. So the Lord, here's how he was with him. So the Lord energized and encouraged Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, the high priest, Joshua, son of Jehozadak, and the whole remnant of the people. They came and worked on the temple of their God, the Lord who rules over all. This took place on the 24th day of the sixth month of King Darius's second year. Chapter 2, verse 1. Here comes the second message from Haggai. On the 21st day of the seventh month, the Lord spoke again to the prophet Haggai. Ask the following questions to Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, the high priest Joshua, son of Jehozadak, and the remnant of the people. Who among you survivors saw the former splendor of this temple? He's talking about Solomon's temple. How does it look to you now, this present one that they were working on? Isn't it nothing by comparison? And it was, because the materials to build Solomon's temple were superior to the ones that they were using for Zerubbabel's temple. Look at verse 4. Even so, take heart, Zerubbabel, says the Lord. Take heart, Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and all you citizens of the land, says the Lord, and begin to work. For I am with you, says the Lord who rules over all. Again, he's encouraging them. And when he says the Lord rules over all, he said, I'm sovereign. Don't worry about your enemies that are trying to stop this or intimidate you into stopping doing this work. Verse 5, do not fear, because I have made a promise to your ancestors when they left Egypt, and my spirit even now testifies to you. Moreover, the Lord who rules over us all says, in just a little while, I will once again shake the sky and the earth and the sea and the dry ground. And so when he's talking about that, he's saying, in the same way, I was with the Exodus generation. When I shook the earth, when I gave the law, and I shook the earth when I judged Egypt and Pharaoh and removed the Exodus generation from Egypt by my power. So I'm going to do it again in the future. And he goes on to say in verse 7, I will also shake up all the nations. And that's referring to the tribulation period and the second advent of Christ. And they will offer their treasures, the nations. Then they will offer their treasures to Christ during his millennial kingdom. And then I will fill this temple with glory, the future temple, says the Lord who rules over all. So he's referencing the millennial temple. We know that because at what time in history has he shook up all the nations? And as a result, the nations bring their treasures to the temple in Jerusalem. It's never happened in history. Not even during the first advent of Christ, but it will happen during the second advent of Christ, his millennial kingdom, the millennial reign. Verse 8, the silver and the gold will be mine, says the Lord who rules over all. The future splendor of this temple will be greater than that of the former times. The Lord who rules over all declares, and in this place I will give peace. There's never been peace for any of the temples in Jerusalem in its history because they've had war and they've been destroyed, these temples. Well, the millennial temple will have peace because the Prince of Peace will be ruling over the earth for 1,000 years. Verse 10, on the 24th day, here's the third message. On the 24th day of the ninth month of Darius's second year, the Lord spoke again to the prophet Haggai. The Lord who rules over all says, ask the priests about the law. If someone carries holy meat and a fold of his garment, and that fold touches bread, a boiled dish, wine, olive oil, or any other food, will that item become holy? The priest answered, it will not. Then Haggai asked, if a person who is richly unclean because of touching a dead body comes in contact with one of these items, will it become unclean? And the priest answered, it will be unclean. Then Haggai responded, the people of this nation are unclean in my sight. And this is prior to them resuming the work. And so is all their effort. Everything they offer is also unclean. Now, therefore, reflect carefully on the recent past before one stone was laid on another in the Lord's temple. From that time, when one came expecting a heap of 20 measures, there were only 10. And when one came to the wine vat to draw out 50 measures from it, there were only 20. I struck all the products of your labor with blight, disease, and hail, and yet you have brought nothing to me, says the Lord. Now, again, it's basically resuming the thought that he had in the first chapter. If you notice, the previous two verses, are actually reflecting what he said about the remnant of Israel before they resumed the work on the temple and obeyed Haggai's command to do that. Verse 18, think carefully about the past. From today, the 24th day of the ninth month, to the day work on the temple was resumed. See, think about it. The seed is still in the storehouse, isn't it? And the vine, fig tree, pomegranate, and olive tree have not produced. Nevertheless, from today on, I will bless you. So as they resume the work of the temple, completing it, rebuilding it, God's saying, I am going to bless you now. The discipline, in other words, has been lifted because of your obedience. Look at verse 20. Then the Lord spoke again to Haggai on the 24th day of the month. Tell Zerubbabel, governor of Judah, I'm ready to shake the sky and the earth. I will overthrow royal thrones and shatter the might of earthly kingdoms. I will overthrow chariots and those who ride them, and horses and their riders will fall as people kill one another. Again, he's speaking of the tribulation period and particularly the second advent of Christ, which ends that period. Verse 23, on that day, says the Lord who rules over all, I will take you, Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, my servant, says the Lord, and I will make you like a signet ring, for I have chosen you, says the Lord, who rules over all. And as a reference, not specifically to Zerubbabel, but that to his a descendant of his who would be Jesus Christ. Because if you look in the Gospels, Jesus is a descendant of Zerubbabel. He came from the king of Judah, line of Judah. Jesus did, and so did Zerubbabel. And the kings of Judah came from Judah. So there we have basically the whole book. And we have the book, and we've gone through it several times now. Now let's get right to it with regards to the literary genre. Because if we don't know literary genre that we're reading, then we're in trouble. And there's different types of genre, literary genres, in the Bible. And we're going to point those out before we can start to understand what I mean about the literary genre of Haggai. We need to know something about literary genre. So a great book by a man on Basic Bible Interpretation. It's by Zuck, a man named Roy Zuck. And it's a great book, even if you're a layperson. I think it's really not too technical at all and very good. And if you're a layperson, I would say, you're not a pastor, I would pick this book up if you ever had extra bucks hanging around, because he does a really good job in helping you understand about how to interpret the Bible, basic interpretation principles. So, and it's really, it's not too technical. And I wouldn't recommend any technical books on hermeneutics, interpretation, to people who are not pastors. I would just try to do something that's less technical. So Zuck has the following comment, and he's talking about literary genre. He says, literary genre refers to the category or the kind of writing characterized by a particular form or forms and or content, distinguishing the various genres, kinds of literature in scripture helps us interpret the Bible more accurately. So again, let's stop there for a second. When you talk about literary genre, we're talking about the kind of literature you're reading. So the Bible, if you were just somebody who's just studying the Bible just for kicks, okay, or you're a teacher in a university or high school, the Bible is very fascinating just to study it in its literary genres. Various literary genres, because it has all types. It has apocalyptic literature, poetry, epistles, letter writing, all types of historical narrative, prophecy. It has all these various types of literature. And those, another way of saying literary genre is types of literature or kinds of literature. So let's go on to the quote, finish off the quote from Zuck. He says, we do this with all kinds of literature. We distinguish between lyric, poetry, and legal briefs, between newspaper accounts of current events and epic poems. We distinguish between the style of historical narratives and sermons, end of quote. So he's saying, you know, read a newspaper. Well, when you're reading a newspaper and you're reading poetry, there's a big difference, okay? You're not going to interpret a newspaper account as you would poetry, okay? And vice versa. And for instance, when you get an email from your boss, and say you're an engineer firm, and he's talking, and your boss is talking about engineering things that you're working on at work. Well, you're going to read that email not as poetry or prophetic literature or anything like that, or as an epistle from Paul, a romance novel. No, you're going to take it as what it is. It's a letter from your boss. It's an email from your boss. So that is its own type of literature in itself. And if you don't get that, and you start, you know, taking your boss as writing apocalyptically to you, or in analogies and stuff, you're going to get fired from your job if you don't read the email and its proper understanding, its proper type of literature it is. Now, in the Bible, we have all kinds of types of literature. We have, first of all, a legal genre, we call it, which appears in the Pentateuch, the first five books of your Bible. Remember, we studied Exodus. That is filled with what we call legal type of literature. And legal literature, in other words, refers to the body of material that includes commandments for the Israelites. And you see this in pretty much all of Deuteronomy, and you see it in portions of Exodus. And you also see it in Numbers, and you see it definitely in Leviticus as well. So that's very important. So let's say when we did Exodus, chapters 20 through 40 are all what we call legal type of literature. It has legal language. In fact, the whole covenant, establishing the covenant with the Mosaic covenant with Israel, was a legal matter between God and the nation of Israel. And then there's another genre that appears in the Bible quite frequently, and we saw that in Daniel, and we saw it in Exodus. It's narrative literature, which is what's narrative? A narrative is a story told for the purpose of conveying a message through people and their problems and situations. So let's take, for instance, Numbers is like that. Quite a bit of Numbers is like that. It's a story. Even a great portion of Jeremiah is like a narrative as well. Genesis is the big one. Genesis is the big narrative. It's a story of, you know, God and creation, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Noah, all these guys, Joseph. And it's basically the narrative literature of Genesis is trying to convey a message to God's people through these people that we see in Genesis, like Noah and Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Joseph. And it presents their problems and various situations that they encountered to teach us something. Basically, in other words, to walk by faith in God. Now, biblical narratives are also selective and illustrative. Biblical narratives are not intended to be full biographies giving every individual detail of an individual's life. So when we get the story of Jacob's sons, and like we get to Joseph, we don't know every last thing about him. The writer is Moses is being selective. And it's the same thing with the Gospels. You know, people go, and this is where they impose their 21st century American way of thinking. When they look at the Gospels, they say, where's Jesus in the lost years, they call it? Where was he from 12 years old? We don't see anything about him in his teenage years until all of a sudden he has his ministry at 30. Last time we heard from him, he was age 12. What was he doing in between those years? Well, why doesn't the Gospels mention this? Because the Gospel writers didn't think it was important. They selected events. Obviously, they knew, Luke knew and Matthew and Peter, they knew the life about Jesus because John the Baptist, they all knew who Jesus, you know, where he came from and everything. And they were told these things. But when they wrote their Gospels, they didn't see it important to make known what he was doing during those years. In fact, actually, Luke gives a summarization of what Jesus did during those years. He obeyed his Joseph and Mary, and he grew in stature with God and men. That's a summarization of what he did right up to the time he proclaimed himself to Israel as the Messiah. So they're selective in their materials. So people, when they look at the Gospels, like for instance, or these historical narratives, in Genesis, they're looking for it. Like today, when we read biographies about people, you know, when I get a book on Churchill or Douglas MacArthur or John F. Kennedy or Franklin Roosevelt or Lincoln, you know, the writers today, the historians, they're writing and getting exhaustive detail about these guys. Well, the ancient writers, the biblical writers, didn't do that. They didn't see fit to do that. They had a different way of writing. And they wrote the things they did about Jesus, for instance, in the Gospels, because they were trying to tell you something about Jesus. And so they weren't trying to give you an exhaustive chronology of everything he was doing in his life from the day he was born to the day he died on the cross. Okay? So under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the biblical writers carefully selected the material they intended to accomplish certain purposes. Now, biblical narratives usually follow a pattern in which a problem occurs near the beginning of the narrative, with increasing complications that reach a climax. So let's say, for instance, Joseph. You read Genesis 37. Joseph, his father gives him the coat of many colors, and he doesn't. Jacob doesn't give it to anybody else among his boys. He just gives it to Joseph. He's playing favorites with Joseph. It creates problems. And then problems started happening between the brothers and Joseph so much that it results in them actually trying to kill him. They're persuaded not to by one of the brothers, and they sell him into slavery. And then he ends up in Egypt, and they develop that from there on. So that's what we're talking about here. Biblical narratives, like the Joseph narrative in Genesis, follow a particular pattern in which a problem occurs near the beginning of the narrative, okay, with increasing complications that reach a climax. Now, then it moves, these narratives move toward a solution of the problem and concludes with the problem solved. So by the time you see Joseph, He's, you know, he gets incarcerated again. He works for Potiphar, and then Potiphar's wife tries to make a sexual advance on him. He rebuffs her, and then he gets thrown in jail because she falsely accuses him of having her way with her. And so he ends up in jail again. And then you got the whole deal with the dreams of the two of the people who are in jail there. They were in Pharaoh's house, and they both have dreams, and Joseph is able to interpret their dreams, just like Daniel did, interestingly enough. And so they say one's going to die and the other one lives. And of course, that's exactly what happens. But nobody tells anybody about this, about Joseph, until later on, Pharaoh has a dream. And then the guy says, hey, I know a guy who can interpret dreams. He interpreted my dream. And he brings Joseph in finally. And then Joseph, next thing you know, he's the prime minister because he could tell Pharaoh his dream. And he was giving advice to Pharaoh as to how he should do, what he should do about this dream that he had from God, which is basically talking about 7 years of famine and 7 years of tremendous crop production in Egypt. And so he could prepare for the great famine. And of course, that famine is what brings Jacob and his sons back into Egypt. And then the story comes to a climax, and Joseph reunites with his brothers and his father, and there's a reconciliation. So that's an example. All that Joseph narrative is an example of what we're talking about, biblical narratives. Now, as the problem develops in the narrative, suspense usually intensifies, and issues and relationships become more complicated until they reach a climax. And that's just what I described to you in the Joseph narrative in Genesis chapter 37 to 50. Now, there are different types of narratives. You probably say, oh, I didn't know there was different types of narratives. Yeah, there's different types of narratives in the Bible. First, in fact, in all types, a lot of types of literature, in English literature, whatever it is, there's different types of narratives. Like, for instance, a tragedy, a story of the decline of a person from verity to catastrophe, such as Samson, Saul, and Solomon. Those guys are a classic example of tragedies. You've heard of Greek tragedies. I mean, I don't know, when you're in high school or college, you read tragedies. Well, the Greeks were famous for this stuff. And so the Bible has this stuff as well. There's the tragedy of Samson. There's the tragedy of Saul's life, and Solomon, for that matter. Also, another type of narrative is epic. That's a series of episodes unified around an individual or a group of people. An example of this is Israel's wilderness wanderings. So that's an epic that we saw. Remember, we studied in Exodus, and they're wandering around. Numbers records this too. Their Exodus generation wandering around for 40 years before they go in the promised land. That's what we call a type of a narrative that's called an epic. And then there's romance. You might say, the Bible has romance? Oh, yes, it does. The Book of Ruth and the Song of Songs. Is Song of Solomon. Those are examples of romance. So some people might say, I never knew the Bible had romance. Of course it does. The Bible has everything. That's why I said, if you were just going to study the Bible for its literature, you could have a great college course on it, because the Bible has got more types of literature than any other book in the history of the world. It's amazing. So romance narrative is a narrative in which the romantic relationship between a man and a woman is narrated. So, we see that with in the Book of Ruth, that great story of Ruth and the man that was ends up marrying her. It's a great romance. And then number four, another type of narrative is heroic. That's a story built around the life and exploits of a hero or a protagonist, an individual who sometimes is a representative of others or an example for others. An example of that is Abraham. The narrative about Abraham is a heroic narrative. Gideon and Judges 7, 8, 9, those chapters, is an example of heroic narrative literature. David in the 1st and 2nd Samuel is another example of that particular genre. Daniel, we studied the book of Daniel. That was a type of narrative that contained portions of Daniel were about Daniel, and they were called that type of narrative about him in his life is heroic narrative, like Daniel 6, where he prayed and he got in trouble for praying, and they tried to the Persian ruler Darius was the people around him, his cabinet hated Daniel, and they tried to get Daniel in trouble so much so they get thrown in the den of lions. And so that is a heroic story of Daniel. And then there's another type of narrative called satire. What's satire? Satire is an exposure of human vice or folly through ridicule or rebuke. Jonah, remember we studied the book of Jonah. Jonah is a satire. It's a satire because Jonah, as a representative of Israel, is ridiculed, rebuked for his refusal to accept God's universal love. So we saw in that book, you know, Jonah said, God told Jonah, go and, you know, go to Nineveh. Well, he didn't want to go to Nineveh because he knew God would save them if they, you know, obey his message, God would save. And he doesn't want that because the Assyrians, the Ninevites, were the arch enemies of Israel at the time. It would be like sending a Jew to in 1946 and sending them to Nazi Germany and to give somebody the gospel. They were enemies, you know, they hated. So Jonah was rebuked. That's a satire. When the person is rebuked or ridiculed for their bad attitude or refusal to accept God's will. Now, number six, another type of narrative is polemic. A polemic is an aggressive attack against or refuting the views of others. You see that kind of in the Paul's Romans. He attacks basically indirectly the Judaizers in that particular book. So a polemic is an aggressive attack against or refuting the views of others. An example of that is Elijah. Remember, he took on the 450 Baal prophets and also the 10 plagues that God administered to the nation of Egypt for not letting the Israelites go out from Egypt and worship him in the desert. So that's another example of a polemic. Now, another genre that appears in Scripture is poetry. In fact, poetry, the book of Job. When you read the book of Job, I talk to people who like the book of Job throughout the years. And a lot of times when they're reading this, studying this book, they're totally unfamiliar with the fact that it's poetry. So you have to be careful when you read Job. And if you don't understand its poetry, you can misinterpret things and take things as being literal when they're actually just being a poetic expressions. So that's very important. You got to be careful of that. So there's poetry all over the place in the Bible, in the Old Testament. Job, I mentioned Psalms. The Psalms are poetry. Proverbs is a type of poetry. And then there's Ecclesiastes, contains poetry. And also Song of Songs. That contains poetry as well. So those books I just mentioned are five major poetical books. But we must keep in mind that poetry is included in many of the prophetic books. And we studied that in Zephaniah. And what we're going to say is Haggai has got many features of poetry. In fact, it is poetry. It's actually what we will see is called poetic prose. Now, wisdom literature is another type of genre in the Bible. What's wisdom literature? Well, Job has wisdom literature, and Proverbs does as well. The writers of Proverbs, Solomon and Agur, they basically talking to the young people, that were Solomon's son, and basically this is wisdom and how to live your life. Well, Proverbs is a type of literature which we call wisdom literature. And also Ecclesiastes is the same as well. In fact, I just read an article in Bibliotheca Sacra done by Roy Zuck, quite interestingly, where when you look at Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, they actually complement each other. And in fact, Solomon had a part in both books. So they complement each other, and they're very quite interesting how they go together. So when we do Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, I'd like to do them back to back so we get a good idea of what they're saying together together. Now, so we also need to understand that not all poetic literature material is wisdom literature. So some of these books contain different types of literature mixed in. That's true in a lot of the books, like Daniel. Daniel is historical narrative, but it's also apocalyptic. It's got chapter 7 has got a lot of apocalyptic imagery. Same with Zechariah. Zechariah has got historical narrative, but it also has a lot of apocalyptic literature, symbols, and like Revelation. So Revelation is the only book in the Old Testament, New Testament, that's what we call apocalyptic. But Zechariah's got apocalyptic literature. Daniel has some. Those are two of the Old Testament, big Old Testament books that have apocalyptic literature. Now, the Gospels. When we talk about the Gospels, they're another genre as well. Some people call them historical biographies. In the ancient world, historical biographies were, again, not like the biographies that we read today in American literature in the West in the 21st century, where everything is chronologically done and every minute detail of the person's life is tracked chronologically, one thing after the other, and you see the whole picture of their life. The biblical writers, the gospel writers, did not do that. So some approach the gospel, gospels as simply historical narratives, as if the books were written simply to record biographical information on the life of Christ. However, the gospels are not simply biographies in the normal sense, and that they exclude much material from the life of Christ, like I mentioned earlier about the years from 12 to 30, we know nothing about him. So that in a historical biography, today, you would expect to see that information. Like if you're reading a life of Lincoln, well, what did he do during 12 years old to 30? Okay, well, people want to know. Well, the biblical writers, that wasn't necessarily important to them. The gospel writers, when they wrote these gospels, they would take information about the life of Christ, which they knew there was a pool of information that the gospel writers had to take information. And so that information, it was selective because they had a purpose. So for instance, like Matthew. Matthew, if you look at it, it's got tons of Old Testament quotations. It's actually written for the Jewish people. And that book is directed toward them. Luke is directed to the Gentiles. And Mark is written toward, actually, the Romans. So the information they selected that they had on Christ and selected was for a purpose, to try to communicate something to different groups of people. And John had his information. He put together his gospel, and his gospel's different, markedly different than Matthew, Mark, and Luke, which we call synoptic gospels because they share a lot of the same information. But John's totally different because John had a different purpose. In fact, the book it's set up in seven signs, that gospel, and he says at the end of the book why he wrote this book, so that you might believe that Jesus is the Son of God and you might have life in his name, through faith in his name. So that's the purpose of the gospel of John. So the Gospels, they do include quite a bit of biographical material on Jesus, but they are more than biographies since they contain both doctrine and narrative, which set forth information on the person of Jesus Christ. In fact, you'll see in the Gospels, like John's making commentary, his own commentary and theological things about what Jesus said. Like, for instance, John 7, he talks about the gift of the Spirit, pools of river water, living water will pour out from you. And John makes a little commentary. He says, that's speaking of the Spirit, the gift of the Spirit, who would be given to them when they believe in Jesus after the day, from the day of Pentecost on. So John makes little commentaries of himself in doctrinal teaching as he's going through the different things about Jesus' life. Now, Jesus' teaching is found in parables and in direct discourse are interspersed with the records of his miracles and encounters with individuals. Now, this leads us to another genre that appears, and we've seen quite a bit of this in Paul's writings and John's, is logical discourse, which is called epistolary literature. Epistolary means it's a letter. Epistle means a letter. So Philippians, Colossians, 1 John, those are all we were doing 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, Romans. Those are all what we call epistles. And so those epistles are called logical discourse. And Romans is an example of logical discourse, which contains many different types of literature, like diatribe and rhetorical questions to bring forth this logical discourse. Now, these epistles, these logical discourses, contain two kinds of material. One, what we call expository discourse. That means expounding certain truths or doctrines often with logical support for those truths. So Paul says something in Romans about justification by faith, and then he'll quote the Old Testament to support what he says. That's an example of expository discourse. There's also hortatory discourse. What is that? It's exhortations to follow certain courses of action or to develop certain characteristics in light of the truths presented in the expository discourse material. So we saw that in 1 John, and we see it in Paul's writings, like in Colossians. Hortatory means he'll say things like, let us do this. And basically trying to persuade the people he's writing to a certain course of action. That's an example, a type of literature called hortatory discourse. Lastly, there's prophetic literature. That constitutes another genre that appears in the Bible. This genre includes predictions of the future. We see that in Daniel 2 and 7 and 9. At the time, prophetic literature contains predictions of the future at the time of the writing of the material, with injunctions often included with those who hear the prophecy to adjust their lives in light of the predictions. There is also a special form of prophetic literature called apocalyptic. That's the book of Revelation. It's got a lot of symbols, and it focuses on the end times. And these symbols are speaking of real persons and events and things, but there's in symbolic language. So Christ comes back and a sharp sword comes from his mouth. It's apocalyptic literature. It's not saying a literal sword's coming out of Jesus' mouth, like you're watching some superhero movie or something. It's apocalyptic literature. It just simply means that when Jesus gives the command to destroy and kill, it's done. He can speak the word. So it's like his words are like a sharp, literal sword coming out of his mouth to kill people. That's apocalyptic literature. So we have another quote from Zuck before we finish off the lesson and tell you what Haggai is all about. Zuck writes the following. He says, and the importance of knowing your literary genre, the type of literature you're reading. He says this, an awareness of the literary genre or kind of literature of a given book helps more in synthesis than detailed analysis. It helps give us a sense of the overall thrust of the Bible book so that verses and paragraphs can be seen in light of the whole. This helps, he says, prevent the problem of taking verses out of context. Let me stop there. A lot of people take verses out of context to support their point, and they shouldn't be doing that because the literature they're studying does not require them to do that. They're taking, they're quoting some kind of poetry in the Old Testament to support a New Testament narrative or New Testament doctrinal teaching by Paul or something, and it doesn't fit. And so that's how you get into trouble misinterpreting the Bible. He also goes on to say, he says, determining the literary genre gives insight into the nature and the purpose of an entire book, as seen, for example, in the book of Jonah. Structural patterns help us see why certain passages are included where they are. Also, attention to literary genre keeps us from making more of the passage than we should, or from making less of the passage than we should, end of quote. Now, this leads us to the book of Haggai. What is Haggai? What type of genre is it? Well, it appears to be a mixture of what we call prose and poetry. And what do I mean by prose? You might be saying, "What's prose?" Well, if you look at Webster's, they give a couple of good definitions of what prose is. P-R-O-S-E. Prose is the ordinary language people use in speaking or writing. And another definition they give is this: it's a literary medium distinguished from poetry, especially by its greater irregularity and variety of rhythm and its closer correspondence to the patterns of everyday speech. So poetry and prose are different because poetry, we don't talk that way in normal language with each other. Prose is what the book of Haggai is about. In fact, what's interesting about Haggai, he's kind of like what they call him the matter-of-fact guy. He's just plain, simple language. But he has some poetry, but he's right to the point. He tells it like it is, and there's not a lot of stylistic, flourishes and whatnot. He's not as I'd say, poetic as, let's say, King Solomon is, or some of the like Zephaniah or something like that. He's much more down to earth, we could say. So this gets right back to Haggai. Haggai is a mixture of prose and poetry, because the introductory passages, people, are prose, while on the other hand, the messages by the prophet are poetry, since they display features which are typical of Hebrew poetry, and thus it can be described as poetic prose. So in other words, because of the types of literature language that Haggai uses, we know he's being poetic, he's using poetry, but he's also using prose. He's mixing the two genres together. So Haggai, he employs different things like antithesis and rhyme. He also uses repetition more than any other feature characterizes the style of Haggai, because he uses that introductory formula, this is what the Lord says, or variations upon this formula 26 times. So you might be saying, why in the world? You see this, remember we did Daniel, and there was a section, Daniel 3, where it's repetition. He says this thing, and it's like, oh, it's like he repeated the same thing. But it's not exact, but there's a lot of repetition. Why do the Old Testament, now, in our day and age, we go, in America, we're like, I don't want the repetition. I already know what you said. Why are you repeating it again? Well, in the ancient literature, they were different than us. They used repetition. Why did they use it? Well, they used it for emphasis and to clarify some point. So there was a purpose. They weren't just repeating themselves for the sake of repetition because they were senile, or they had, dementia. No, they did it because there was a point in it, to clarify a point and to emphasize. Here's the other reason. They also did it for memorization. The people in the ancient world were audio. They were better listeners than we are. We're all visual in our country, in our society. We're the television generation, internet generation. Everything's visual with us. But back then, they listened and they used different devices like repetition so they could remember the story. That's why you look at Jesus. You sit there, how do these guys remember all that stuff that Jesus said? Because Jesus is a great teacher. He used a lot of repetition so that they could remember. He would use very memorable sayings, and he repeats things. And so that they had but that repetition allowed them to remember the story. And that's another reason why they use repetition in the ancient, in the Bible, among the biblical writers. And so that's a very common feature that we see in Book of Haggai. You see, I pointed this out many times. You see the expression, the Lord who rules over all says this, over and over again. We already got that, right, God? No. You think you got it. But every time he uses that expression, he uses it in relation to something else. They build upon each other. Yeah, he repeats, but he builds upon the repetition, and he lays on. It's like building a house. You used to have the foundation, you know, the next level, boom, 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 and until you have the roof and everything, and you're putting the shutters on, you paint the thing and everything. And that's the way they built. They built a story, is what they did. They were great builders in a literary sense. You also see, when you talk about repetition in Haggai, we see the phrase, consider your ways. We've seen that, or I am with you. Or consider repetition. We see that these expressions over and over again for emphasis. And also there's obvious repetition in Haggai 1:14 with the word spirit occurs three times in the verse. There's repetition in Haggai 2:4 because we have the word hazak, be strong, appears three times in that verse. And also the expression, I am with you, appears in Haggai 1:13 and 2:4. Why? To reiterate that God was going to give them the strength and the power to do what they needed to do, that he wanted them to do, and that to encourage them not to be intimidated by your enemies. And that's just some of the things he uses for this repetition. There's also the phrase, the word of the Lord, that appears in Haggai. It occurs five times. And there's the phrase, thus says the Lord of hosts, or as the NET Bible says, the Lord who rules over all. I like that better. That appears seven times in this book, telling you that God is telling the remnant of Israel or Judah that God is sovereign and that he's in control of their circumstances and that he is imminent, meaning he's involved in their affairs and he cares about them. Those are all things that we need to know about God. Well, he's telling Israel with this expression, we need to know about God in our day and age as well. And then there's also the phrase, declares the Lord of hosts. That occurs six times. And then lastly, says the Lord. That phrase appears eight times in the book of Haggai. Now, another feature, we're going to wrap it up here. We start a little bit late. Another feature which demonstrates the literary ability of Haggai is his use of rhetorical questions. There's several rhetorical questions in the book of Haggai. Paul uses these all the time. He uses a rhetorical question in Romans in order to present the arguments of his opponents to the gospel in order to defeat them. Not a straw man argument. It's not a straw man argument. It's basically, this is what they say, and I'll give you this rhetorical question, and then I'm going to answer it. So the first rhetorical question in Haggai is found in Haggai 1:4, and it's used to rebuke the remnant of Judah for failing to complete the rebuilding of the temple while they sat in their own homes. Look at Haggai chapter 1. Look at Haggai chapter 1 and look at verse 4. Is it right for you to live in richly paneled houses while my temple is in ruins? There's the first rhetorical question. Why is he saying that? He's condemning them. He's convicting them. He's saying, you're putting your priorities, your homes ahead of my house. Am I not more important than you? And my house more important than you? Yes. So he uses a rhetorical question there. He could have just come right out and condemned them, but he uses a rhetorical question to get them to think. I mean, he could have just come flat out and rebuked them, but instead he used a rhetorical question, which is a great way, an effective way to address a bad attitude. Like parents have done that. My father and mother used to do this. They ask me a question. It's like, oh yeah, I know the answer to that. They didn't even have to go and say full frontal attack on me and say, you, da, da, da. All they do is they ask the question. You say, oh, I feel bad. Sometimes that's more effective, and that's what God uses. Another rhetorical question is in verse 9. Look at verse 9. You expected a large harvest, but instead there was little, and when you brought it home, it disappeared right away. Why? Asked the Lord who rules over all. That's the second rhetorical question in the book, and this rhetorical question is another rebuke to the remnant of Israel for failing to rebuild the temple. There's a third rhetorical question in chapter 2, verse 3. Look at that. Chapter 2, verse 3. Who among you survivors saw the former splendor of this temple? How does it look to you now? Isn't it nothing by comparison? There's three of them there. So the third one, it's posed by the Lord through Haggai, and it's addressed to Zerubbabel, Joshua, and the remnant of Judah. And the purpose of this question is this time is not to rebuke them, but to encourage them to complete the task of rebuilding the temple. And the fourth and fifth rhetorical questions appear in verses 12 through 13, and they're directed toward the priests. And we won't read those now because we're running out of time. The purpose of these questions is designed to emphasize with the priests that the remnant of Judah, prior to obeying the command to rebuild the temple, was unclean. And the sixth rhetorical question that's found in Haggai is found in Haggai 2, 15 through 17. And this question is emphasizing with the remnant of Judah that they were not blessed materialistically by the Lord because of their failure to rebuild the temple. And then lastly, the seventh and final rhetorical question is found in verses 18 and 19. And these questions emphasize, or this question, emphasizes with the remnant that disobedience to the Lord resulted in the nation being impoverished, whereas they would be blessed materialistically as a result of their obedience to his command to rebuild the temple. So the rhetorical questions are basically telling us about Haggai and his style. And so he liked to use rhetorical questions much like the Apostle Paul used to. And so Haggai, the book is poetic prose. It's speech of the ordinary people mixed in with poetry. And he uses repetition and rhetorical questions to basically either to rebuke the remnant of Judah for not completing the temple or to encourage them to continue forward and complete the task of rebuilding the temple. So he uses everything at his command as a writer. So everybody's different. Paul's literary style is different than Haggai, and Solomon's is different from John, and Peter's is different than Jeremiah. They're all different, and they all had different skill levels, And so God used every single one of them in the ministry of the Holy, under the ministry of the Holy Spirit, to communicate his complete and connected thought to Israel or the church, which whoever he was writing to, and mankind. And in perfect accuracy, he was able to do this through the ministry of the Holy Spirit, through men like Haggai. Well, you've been a great audience, and we'll pick this up Thursday evening. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to study your word. We pray that this lesson would help us understand the book of Haggai and interpret it accurately and correctly so that we can make a proper application and learn from this book and grow from this book. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.